afternoon, ready for the first instalment of Percy Jackson this week, and I think we will finish in the next couple of days. Okay, chapter 21. I settle my tab. It's funny how humans can wrap their mind around things and fit them into their version of reality. Chiron had told me that long ago. As usual, I didn't appreciate his wisdom until much later. According to the LA News, the explosion at the Santa Monica Beach had been caused when a crazy kidnapper fired a shotgun at a police car. He accidentally hit a gas main that had ruptured during the earthquake. This crazy kidnapper, aka Ares, was the same man who had abducted me and two other adolescents in New York and brought us across country on a 10-day odyssey of terror. Poor little Percy Jackson wasn't an international criminal after all. He'd caused a commotion on that Greyhound bus in New Jersey trying to get away from his captor. And afterwards, witnesses would even swear they had seen the leather-clad man on the bus. Why didn't I remember him before? The crazy man had caused the explosion in the St. Louis Arch. After all, no kid could have done that. A concerned waitress in Denver had seen the man threatening his abductees outside her diner, gotten a friend to take a photo and notified the police. Finally, brave Percy Jackson, I was beginning to like this kid, had stolen a gun from his captor in Los Angeles and battled him gunshot to rifle on the beach. Police had arrived just in time, but in the spectacular explosion, five police cars had been destroyed and the captor had fled. No fatalities had occurred. Percy Jackson and his two friends were safely in police custody. The reporters fed us this whole story. We just nodded and acted tearful and exhausted, which wasn't hard, and played victimised kids for the cameras. All I want, I said, choking back my tears, is to see my loving stepfather again. Every time I saw him on TV, calling me a delinquent punk, I knew somehow we would be okay. And I know he'll want to reward each and every person in this beautiful city of Los Angeles with a free major appliance from his store. Here's the phone number. The police and reporters were so moved that they passed around the hat and raised money for three tickets on the next plane to New York. I knew there was no choice but to fly. I hoped Zeus would cut me some slack, considering the circumstances. But it was still hard to force myself on board the flight. Takeoff was a nightmare. Every spot of turbulence was scarier than a Greek monster. I didn't unclench my hands from the armrests until we touched down safely at LaGuardia. The local press was waiting for us outside security, but we managed to evade them thanks to Annabeth, who lured them away in her invisible Yankees cap, shouting, "They're over by the frozen yoghurt, come on!" then rejoined us at baggage claim. We split up at the taxi stand. I told Annabeth and Grover to get back to Half Blood Hill and let Chiron know what had happened. They protested, and it was hard to let them go after all we'd been through, but I knew I had to do this last part of the quest by myself. If things went wrong, if the gods didn't believe me, I wanted Annabeth and Grover to survive to tell Chiron the truth. I hopped in a taxi and headed into Manhattan. 30 minutes later, I walked into the lobby of the Empire State Building. I must have looked like a homeless kid with my tattered clothes and my scraped up face. I hadn't slept in at least 24 hours. I went up to the guard at the front desk and said, 600th floor. He was reading a huge book with a picture of a wizard on the front. I wasn't much into fantasy, but the book must have been good because the guard took a while to look up. No such floor, kiddo. I need an audience with Zeus. He gave me a vacant smile. Sorry? You heard me. I was about to decide this guy was just a regular mortal and I'd better run for it before he called the straitjacket patrol when he said, no appointment, no audience, kiddo. Lord Zeus doesn't see anyone unannounced. Oh, I think he'll make an exception. I slipped off my backpack and unzipped the top. The guard looked inside at the metal cylinder, not getting what it was for a few seconds. Then his face went pale. That isn't. Yes, it is, I promised. You want me to take it out? No! He scrambled out of his seat, fumbled around his desk for a key card, then handed it to me. Insert this in the security slot. Make sure nobody else is in the elevator with you. I did as he told me. As soon as the elevator doors closed, I slipped the key into the slot. The card disappeared and a new button appeared on the console. A red one that said 600. I pressed it and waited and waited. Music played. Raindrops keep falling on my head. Finally, ding, the door slid open. I stepped out and almost had a heart attack. I was standing on a narrow stone walkway in the middle of the air. Below me was Manhattan from the height of an aeroplane. In front of me, white marble steps wound up the spine of a cloud into the sky. My eyes followed the stairway to its end, where my brain just could not accept what I saw. Look again, my brain said. We're looking, my eyes insisted. It's really there. From the top of the clouds rose the decapitated peak of a mountain, its summit covered with snow. Clinging to the mountainside were dozens of multi-level palaces, a city of mansions, all with white-coloured porticos, gilded terraces and bronze braziers glowing with a thousand fires. Roads wound crazily up to the peak, where the largest palace gleamed against the snow. Precariously perched gardens bloomed with olive trees and rose bushes. I could make out an open-air market filled with colourful tents, a stone amphitheatre built on one side of the mountain, a hippodrome and a colosseum on the other. It was an ancient Greek city. Except it wasn't in ruins. It was new and clean and colourful, the way Athens must have looked 2,500 years ago. This place can't be here, I told myself. The tip of a mountain hanging over New York City like a billion-ton asteroid. How could something like that be anchored above the Empire State Building, in plain sight of millions of people and not get noticed? But here it was, and here I was. My trip through Olympus was a daze. I passed some giggling wood nymphs who threw olives at me from their garden. Hawkers in the market offered to sell me ambrosia on a stick, and a new shield, and a genuine glitter weave replica of the Golden Fleece, as seen on Hephaestus TV. The nine muses were tuning their instruments for a concert in the park, while a small crowd gathered, satyrs and naiads and a bunch of good-looking teenagers, who might have been minor gods and goddesses. Nobody seemed worried about an impending civil war. In fact, everybody seemed in a festive mood. Several of them turned to watch me pass and whispered to themselves. I climbed the main road towards the big palace at the peak. It was a reverse copy of the palace in the underworld. There, everything had been black and bronze. Here, everything glittered white and silver. I realised Hades must have built his palace to resemble this one. He wasn't welcomed in Olympus, except on winter solstice, so he'd built his own Olympus underground. Despite my bad experience with him, I felt a little sorry for the guy. To be banished from this place seemed really unfair. It would make anybody bitter. Steps led up to a central courtyard. Past that, the throne room. Room really isn't the right word. The place made Grand Central Station look like a broom closet. Massive columns rose to a domed ceiling, which was gilded with moving constellations. 12 thrones, built for beings the size of Hades, were arranged in an inverted U, just like the cabins at Camp Half-Blood. An enormous fire crackled in the central hearth pit. The thrones were empty except for two at the end, the head throne on the right and the one to its immediate left. I didn't have to be told who the two gods were that were sitting there waiting for me to approach. I came towards them, my legs trembling. The gods were in giant human form, as Hades had been, but I could barely look at them without feeling a tingle, as if my body was starting to burn. Zeus, the lord of the gods, wore a dark blue pinstriped suit. He sat on a simple throne of solid platinum. He had a well-trimmed beard, marbled grey and black, like a storm cloud. His face was proud and handsome and grim, his eyes rainy grey. As I got nearer to him, the air crackled and smelled of ozone. The god sitting next to him was his brother, without a doubt, but he was dressed very differently. He reminded me of a beachcomber from Key West. He wore leather sandals, khaki Bermuda shorts and a Tommy Bahama shirt with coconuts and parrots all over it. His skin was deeply tanned, his hands scarred like an old-time fisherman's. His hair was black, like mine. His face had that same brooding look that had always got me branded a rebel. But his eyes, sea green like mine was surrounded by sun crinkles that told me he smiled a lot too. His throne was a deep sea fisherman's chair. It was the simple swivelling kind with a black leather seat and a built-in holster for a fishing pole. Instead of a pole, the holster held a bronze trident, flickering with green light around the tips. The gods weren't moving or speaking, but there was tension in the air, as if they'd just finished an argument. I approached the fisherman's throne and knelt at his feet. Father, I dared not look up. My heart was racing. I could feel the energy emanating from the two gods. If I said the wrong thing, I had no doubt they could blast me into dust. To my left, Zeus spoke. Should you not address the master of this house first, boy? I kept my head down and waited. Peace, brother, Poseidon finally said. His voice stirred my oldest memories. That warm glow I remembered as a baby. The sensation of this god's hand on my forehead. The boy defers to his father. This is only right. You still claim him then? Zeus asked menacingly. You claim this child whom you sired against our sacred oath? I have admitted my wrongdoing, Poseidon said. Now I would hear him speak. Wrongdoing? A lump welled up in my throat. Was that all I was? A wrongdoing? The result of a god's mistake? I have spared him once already, Zeus grumbled, daring to fly through my domain. Puh! I should have blasted him out of the sky for his impudence. And risk destroying your own master bolt, Poseidon asked calmly. Let us hear him out, brother. Zeus grumbled some more. I shall listen, he decided. Then I shall make up my mind whether or not to cast this boy down from Olympus. Perseus, Poseidon said, look at me. I did, and I wasn't sure what I saw in his face. There was no clear sign of love or approval, nothing to encourage me. It was like looking at the ocean. Some days you could tell what mood it was in. Most days, though, it was unreadable, mysterious. I got the feeling Poseidon really didn't know what to think of me. He didn't know whether he was happy to have me as a son or not. In a strange way, I was glad that Poseidon was so distant. If he'd tried to apologise or told me he loved me or even smiled, it would have felt fake. Like a human dad making some lame excuse for not being around. I could live with that. After all, I wasn't sure about him yet either. Address Lord Zeus, boy, Poseidon told me. Tell him your story. So I told Zeus everything, just as it had happened. I took out the metal cylinder, which began sparking in the sky god's presence, and laid it at his feet. There was a long silence, broken only by the crackle of the hearth fire. Zeus opened his palm. The lightning bolt flew into it. As he closed his fist, the metallic points flared with electricity until he was holding what looked more like a classic thunderbolt, a 5-metre javelin of arcing, hissing energy that made the hairs on my scalp rise. I sense the boy tells the truth, Zeus muttered. But that Ares would do such a thing. It is most unlike him. He's proud and impulsive, Poseidon said. It runs in the family. Lord, I asked. They both said, yes. Ares didn't act alone. Someone else, something else, came up with the idea. I described my dreams and the feeling I'd had on the beach, that momentary breath of evil that had seemed to stop the world and made Ares back off from killing me. In the dreams, I said, the voice told me to bring the bolt to the underworld. Ares hinted that he'd been having dreams too. I think he was being used, just as I was, to start a war. You are accusing Hades after all, Zeus asked. No, I said, I mean Lord Zeus. I've been in the presence of Hades. This feeling on the beach was different. It was the same thing I felt when I got close to that pit. That was the entrance to Tartarus, wasn't it? Something powerful and evil is stirring down there, something even older than the gods. Poseidon and Zeus looked at each other. They had a quick, intense discussion in ancient Greek. I only caught one word, father. Poseidon made some kind of suggestion, but Zeus cut him off. Poseidon tried to argue. Zeus held up his hand, angrily. "We will speak of this no more," Zeus said. "I must go personally to purify this thunderbolt in the waters of Lemnos, to remove the human taint from its metal." He rose and looked at me. His expression softened just a fraction of a degree. "You have done me a service, boy. Few heroes could have accomplished as much." "I had help, sir," I said. "Grover Underwood and Annabeth Chase." "To show you my thanks, I shall spare your life. I do not trust you, Perseus Jackson. I do not like what your arrival means for the future of Olympus. But for the sake of peace in the family, I shall let you live." Thank you, sir. "Do not presume to fly again. Do not let me find you here when I return. Otherwise, you shall taste this bolt, and it shall be your last sensation." Thunder shook the palace. With a blinding flash of lightning, Zeus was gone. I was alone in the throne room with my father. "Your uncle," Poseidon sighed, "has always had a flair for dramatic exits. I think he would have done well as the god of theatre." An uncomfortable silence. "Sir," I said, "what was in that pit?" Poseidon regarded me. "Have you not guessed?" "Kronos," I said, "the king of the Titans." Even in the throne room of Olympus, far away from Tartarus, the name Kronos darkened the room, made the hearth fire seem not quite so warm on my back. Poseidon gripped his trident. "In the first war, Percy, Zeus cut our father, Kronos, into 1,000 pieces, just as Kronos had done to his own father, Uranos. Zeus cast Kronos' remains into the darkest pit of Tartarus. The Titan army was scattered, their mountain fortress on Etna destroyed, their monstrous allies driven to the furthest corners of the earth. And yet Titans cannot die, any more than we gods can. Whatever is left of Kronos is still alive in some hideous way, still conscious in his eternal pain, still hungering for power." "He's healing," I said. "He's coming back." Poseidon shook his head. "From time to time, over the eons, Kronos has stirred. He enters men's nightmares and breathes evil thoughts. He wakens restless monsters from the depths. But to suggest he could rise from the pit is another thing." "That's what he intends, Father. That's what he said." Poseidon was silent for a long time. "Lord Zeus has closed discussion on this matter. He will not allow talk of Kronos. You have completed your quest, child. That is all you need to do." "But..." I stopped myself. Arguing would do no good. It would very possibly anger the only god who I had on my side. As you wish, Father." A faint smile played on his lips. "Obedience does not come naturally to you, does it?" "No, sir." "I must take some blame for that, I suppose. The sea does not like to be restrained." He rose to his full height and took up his trident. Then he shimmered and became the size of a regular man, standing directly in front of me. "You must go, child. But first, know that your mother has returned." I stared at him, completely stunned. "My mother?" "You will find her at home. Hades sent her when you recovered his helmet. Even the Lord of Death pays his debts." My heart was pounding. I couldn't believe it. "Do you? Would you?" I wanted to ask if Poseidon would come with me to see her. But then I realised that was ridiculous. I imagine loading the god of the sea into a taxi and taking him to the Upper East Side. If he'd wanted to see my mom all these years, he would have. And there was smelly Gabe to think about. Poseidon's eyes took on a little sadness. "When you return home, Percy, you must make an important choice. You will find a package waiting in your room." "A package?" "You'll understand when you see it. No one can choose your path, Percy. You must decide." I nodded, though I didn't know what he meant. "Your mother is a queen among women," Poseidon said wistfully. "I had not met such a mortal woman in 1,000 years. Still, I am sorry you were born, child, I have brought you a hero's fate, and a hero's fate is never happy. It is never anything but tragic. I tried not to feel hurt. Here was my own dad telling me he was sorry I'd been born. I don't mind, Father. Not yet, perhaps, he said, not yet. But it was an unforgivable mistake on my part. I'll leave you then, I bowed awkwardly. I won't bother you again. I was five steps away when he called. Perseus? I turned. There was a different light in his eyes, a fiery kind of pride. You did well, Perseus. Do not misunderstand me. Whatever else you do, know that you are mine. You are a true son of the sea god. As I walked back through the city of the gods, conversation stopped. The muses paused their concert. People and satyrs and naiads all turned towards me, their faces filled with respect and gratitude, and, as I passed by, they knelt, as if I was some kind of hero. And I'm going to stop there. Okay? More tomorrow. Bye.